series called Beyond Elementary for serious. Those want to go deeper with the Lord. We've been working our way through the steps up to righteousness, and we've been, tonight we'll be on our third teaching in righteousness. Righteousness, basically, we said is, if you really want to cut to the chase, basically righteousness is really a study about identity. We are really in Christ. I say this over and over again, and I like to repeat things. Neil Anderson says that understanding or discovering my identity or our true identity in Christ is absolutely essential to my success at having a victorious Christian life. How many of you want to have a successful, victorious Christian life?
Amen.
Well, God has a divine destiny, and as a disciple, it's imperative that we know who we are in Christ, or we'll never be able to really reach our full potential. And so the devil knows that if we ever know or ever discover who we really are in Christ, then he's going to be in big trouble.
Yeah.
John 8:44 talks about the devil and his nature. His nature is that he's a liar. Goes on to say, not only is he a liar, but he's the father of all lies. He's the kingpin of all liars. So one of the things that he wants to do to keep us in the darkness from discovering who we really, really are is he likes to lie to us and create what we call an identity crisis. You've heard men get to the age of 40 and they have a middle-age crisis, they call it, and they kind of have an identity fallout and they don't really know who they are, and they have a tendency to get in trouble during that time of their life. But basically, that's what the devil likes to do, and he's been doing it since birth. From the moment we were born, he has been out to undermine God and to, cut in front of what God's doing. We know the devil tried to get to the baby Moses, and he tried to get to the baby Jesus, and it was unsuccessful. But just like he tried to keep Jesus from going to the cross and keep Moses from leading the people out of the promised land, he's always tried to intercede and keep us from going to our promised land and causing identity crisis. It's been going on since we were kids, and eventually he's lied and lied and lied and lied. And life without Christ, without the truth, not knowing the truth, we buy into these lies, and over and over and over, to the point we developed a stronghold in our life, and we end up in what we call a self-imposed prison. How many know what a self-imposed prison is? It's a prison that you put yourself in. Doesn't even have any bars. You can break out any time you want, but when it's self-imposed, that means you put yourself there, and you're the only one that has a key to it. So you're the only one that can let you out. So tonight I want to start off by looking at the first lie. Turn with me to Genesis 1:26. On page one. Chapter 1, verse 26. In the beginning. How many know that's the first baseball game in the Bible? In the beginning. God created the heavens and earth and all these creatures of the field. Then God said in verse 26, let us, who is us? Who's he talking to? Talking to himself, he's talking to the Trinity. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, the three of them. They were there, they always were. We don't know where they came from, but they always were. And so, obviously they're up in heaven and they're creating all these different things, and they come up with another big brainstorm and decide, hey, this not only we created the heavens and earth and these creatures, this creates some people, and this makes some people that are just like us. And so God said, let us, the Trinity, make man in our image. And according to our likeness, circle our likeness. Circle image and circle our likeness. And let them rule, let them take charge, let them have dominion. Put them in authority over all this work that we're going to create. So let's create, just create people in our own image. The word image is our word for statue. Famous people, to let their legacy live on, sometimes create a monument unto themselves and put it out in the middle for everybody to see. And that usually that statue is a perfect copy that looks identical. It's an exact representation of that person physically. Perfect copy of the original. It also means to pattern or to mold something. Mold something into or after the likeness of something. So when God created Adam and Eve, the Trinity made them just exact representatives of what they were like. Perfect copies, exact representations of the Trinity. That's how when he created man, the original man was created physically just like the Trinity. And in their likeness. The word likeness is a very similar word. It also means to be patterned or to resemble something. Then God showed me something today too, and I'll go there, and we didn't get it up here, but jump to Genesis 2:7. Then the Lord God formed man. First he came up with the idea, hey, let's put this together, this people, this creator, just like us, let's put them on the earth and let them rule the earth. Let them have dominion. Let them be in charge. We'll make them just like us. So then the Lord God formed man. He went in and followed through with this. He formed him of the dust of the ground. He breathed their nostrils the breath of life. The word there is the word Hebrew means to have divine inspiration.
Yes.
And man became a living being, and he put him in the garden and said, take care of this and cultivate it, blah, 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 blah. So first he created him physically in his likeness and created him in a statue. And not only that, now when he follows through with that, he forms him physically just like them and makes him just like a statue of the Trinity. And then he breathes his own DNA into them. He put his life. The word in the Greek is Zoe. Zoe life means God life. The life that God enjoys. God breathed into their nostrils his own inspiration, his own passion, the essence, his deity, his glory, everything that he was. Not only did he make him just like him physically, but he put everything about the attributes of the Holy Spirit. He breathed into them all at once, and man became a life giving. In other words, he became like little gods. God, the Father, the Son, the Trinity, and then they made him just like them. Then they breathed their very essence, so they were just like them. Paul Bellheimer says, redeemed humanity, when it's all said and done, when we get back to being like we originally created, men were so close. When God created Adam and Eve, they were so close to being like the Trinity that if they would have been one smidgen more, they would have been the Trinity, a part of the Trinity. Of course, he couldn't let that happen, so... But when he created them originally, they were like just a smidgen. They were far above angels.
Yeah.
So Adam and Eve were like little gods. Now in verse 3, the serpent was more crafty, subtle or tricky. There's our father of lies.
Yeah.
Now I'm going to show you the very first lie. The serpent was crafty, more subtle, more tricky, or deceptive than any other beasts of the field that the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, indeed, has God said, or has God really said, you shall not eat from the tree of the garden. The woman said to the serpent, from the fruit of the trees of the garden we may eat, but from the fruit of the trees which is in the middle of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat, for the day you do, you shall surely die. The serpent said to the woman, you surely will not die. For God knows in the day that you eat from the eyes, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. So the first thing, the actual word, and she even says later on when God questions her about why she listened, he said, she says, well, the serpent, he sees me, or the word is beguiled. That means he got in my head and he messed with my head. Confused me. That's what she blamed it on. One of the things the devil does first is he loves to get into our head.
Yep.
And to lie to us. And he always loves to get us to doubt God. Mm-hmm. How many know when we doubt God, God's God. He's God. Mm-hmm. He's on his throne. He sits on the throne. So when we doubt God, what we really do is we question, we challenge what God said. What we literally do is we take God from being judged. We take him off the throne. Mm-hmm. And we put ourselves on the throne. That's what really is going on there. When we doubt God, we judge God. Mm-hmm. And when you follow through with a judgment, how many know if you act upon that and you hold on to it, it'll turn into resentment that will actually turn into a bitter root spirit. Now, God never told Eve this. God spoke to the man and said, do this, and the man passed it on. So this is where she made her first mistake. She started listening to the devil, and she should have went to her man.
Yeah.
And we find out later on, actually, when this whole conversation was that Adam was with her, the word actually means elbow to elbow. It wasn't like Adam was out working in the garage or watching the football game. He was standing right next to her watching this conversation, and she should have stopped and said, hey, didn't God say this, honey? And what do you think about this? You take care of this devil. It's not my business.
That's right.
So she should have submitted to her husband and said, you take care of this. But in reality, her husband was standing right there, and he didn't even stick up for his wife. He threw her under the bus. His own wife. Now, can you imagine what the first woman in the Bible probably looked like? I bet she was like fine, buddy. That's where they got the word woman. He looked at her and went, whoa, man. So he probably was all stuck on stupid and all googly-eyed and doing all this. And, you know, so the first thing the devil did is he began to lie to her, get in her head and beguile her and confused her. And then verse 5, it says that for God knows that in the day you eat from it, your eyes will be open and you will be like God. Now what's wrong with that right there?
They already were like God.
They couldn't be any more like God.
Right.
He already created them physically. And this is what the Lord should, not only physically did he make them exactly that replicas, but he put his very own DNA that you could not get any more like God without being God.
No.
But the temptation was to try to get them to think, the lie was a temptation to think they had to become more like God when they were already like God. They couldn't become more like God.
Yeah.
So he created doubt in their minds, like, what are you talking about? God's lied to you. And he knows that in the day that you're going to be like him. So the lie was to get them to think they can become even more like God. When there was no way they could. They were already as high as they could get. It don't get no better than that. So he tries to get them to get independent and to lie to them and create doubt to get them to isolate them. The devil loves to isolate you and lie to you and talk to you to get you away from the truth. He likes to bring you away from God, which is the truth. And God says this, God says this, God says this. And he loves to get you away and get you in your own head, independent of God, and get you to doubt God, to judge God, and to get you resentful towards God. Are you with me?
Yes.
Yeah. Matter of fact, God, have you really said? Is that what you really meant? What the devil was trying to say is God's holding that on you, man.
Yeah.
There's more. What he was also doing, and I love the book Search for Significance, is, you know, is that he was trying to get them to find, in other words, he was getting them to be more like, trying to be more like God, but what they were really was thinking they could be more, become more significant. God's not enough. And isn't that what the temptation today is, that God has lied to us and tried to get us to realize that God's not enough, and, you know, and to get us to go out and try to find significance? And here we are on this search, you know, trying to find significance externally. We're on this search externally trying to find it in money and our job and, you know, our education, how we look and our friends. And now we go through all these things trying to find significance, searching in. How many of you know? Nothing, you're not going to find it because you're already significant. If you're born again Christian, you're already significant.
Yes. Amen.
You're significant because you were made in His image. You were made in His likeness. And when you were born again, the moment you were born again, God breathed His DNA and His life into you. You're like a little God. It don't get no better than that. You can add up a little bit more money and a better job and more friends and more toys and different things external. There's nothing necessarily wrong with that. But the lie is to think we can find significance in having women and money and things. And there's nothing wrong with that. But our real significance is found in who we really are. It's in our identity and the truth that we are already significant. We already like God. It don't get no better than that. So it is when it comes to righteousness. The moment I was talking to Pastor Mike down today, and he was talking about how you were fornicators and you were sinners and you were idolaters, all this, and he said, but God.
Yes.
But God. Somewhere in all that stuff, God got a hold of you, man, and He pulled you out of that. It says that He sanctified you. Sanctified is different than the process. It's talking about positionally. It's basically talking about, you know, He got us away and all of a sudden He sanctified. I mean, He positionally made us in right standing. And then it says that He justified you.
Yes.
The minute I turned to the cross, the minute I repented of my sins, the minute I went to Jesus Christ and I said, my righteousness is filthy rags and I'm going to hell and I need you, and I realized there's not a thing I can do. The minute I turned to Him and I looked to the cross, something happened. Immediately, God's right, the righteousness of Jesus Christ, His righteousness was imputed to me. It was put to my account. I didn't earn it. I didn't deserve it. It was unmerited. It was something that was given to me as a gift, as a byproduct. And immediately, I went from being in the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of life, and God imputed His righteousness to me, and I was put into a brand new position where I stand in His righteousness.
Amen. Yes.
And I have been justified. I was, the minute I was justified, that means God stood up and declared that this one is mine. And,
yes.
And I declare that He is a righteous one.
Yes.
And I now declare Him forgiven and right standing with me.
Yes.
There's no hostility. There's nothing against us. I now look at Him and I declare Him as righteous as my Son, Jesus Christ. He's 100% right. He doesn't get any more righteous than that. And I've declared Him in right standing with me just as if He never sinned.
Yes.
It don't get no better than that, does it?
No.
So that's who we are. But the devil doesn't want us to know that, does he?
No.
And so tonight, John 16:18 says, when the Holy Spirit comes, which we have the Holy Spirit, He's got a job to do. One of His roles is to convict us of sin. We know all about that, don't we?
Yes.
Convict us of righteousness and judgment. We know about judgment, but we've never heard much preaching ever about God's Holy Spirit convicting us of righteousness. I don't think I've ever heard anybody ever even preach about that hardly.
No.
So the Holy Spirit wants to convict us tonight, yes, about sin and judgment, but He also wants to convict us about our righteousness, about who we really are. We've been lied to. John 8:32 says, you shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Well, the way we get set free is to know the truth. And when we understand who we really are in Christ, Neil Anderson says that becomes essential to our victorious success. I want to be free. And so tonight we're going to have a paradigm shift, and we're going to talk a little bit more about getting a revelation, a conviction. Conviction means to correct something and to reprove it, but to expose it and reveal the real truth about something. The Holy Spirit's job is to convict us about what righteousness really, really is, and most of us don't have a clue. I'm here to tell you, this whole series is life-changing for me.
Yes.
When I begin to know about that. So tonight we're going to talk about righteousness, part 3. We're talking about imputed and imparted. Tonight we're going to talk more about imputed. And we're going to talk about the book, and go ahead and put it up, Josh, called Turkeys and Eagles. This is a book that was taught by Peter Lord years ago. And it was one of the most popular things he ever did, and it went on for weeks and things, and I caught the tail end of it, I think, and I got a hold of this book, and I read it, and this nailed it, man. This book nailed it. Once I read this, it's just a simple book. How many of you ever read Pilgrim's Progress?
Yeah.
Or Hinds Feet in High Places. It's one of those kind of books, you know, or like The Shack or something. A lot of analogies. But this book nailed it for me. And so if you want to buy one of these, I think Damien has a few of them. We were able to get some more of them. They're kind of hard to come by. We've got a few more of them. So tonight we're going to talk about turkeys and eagles. We're going to find out, have you been turkeyized? Or how many of you heard the saying out there, it's hard to soar with the eagles when you've been hanging out with turkeys?
Yeah.
The question I have, or in the book, is that what in the world is an eagle doing hanging out with turkeys in the first place? I mean, we become like those that we hang around. You wake up, you lay down with dogs, you wake up with fleas, don't you? So obviously, if someone is an eagle and they're hanging out with turkeys, then they really don't know they're an eagle, do they? So tonight, I want to talk to the story about turkeys and eagles and give a Reader's Digest version of it. But before that, all of you have gotten a little pretest, right? You can go ahead and you can leave it up there. You can leave it up there. Now, some of you have taken this test before, so don't go spoiling it for everybody else. But we don't have a lot of time, so just don't think too much. Just breathe. Just go through this thing real quick, and I'm going to give you a couple minutes to take this test. So go ahead and take this test. No cheating back there, Lance. Just thank Jamie for the answers. All right, we can continue to work on that a little later. Tonight, I want to say, talk about the story. I want to kind of do a Reader's Digest. I kind of twisted it to my own, so I'm trying to make exactly like the book, for sure. Basically, the story about turkeys and eagles, there was a family of eagles that lived way, way, way high up in a tree. Mom and Dad were starting out, new family, and had a little girl eaglet, a little boy eaglet. And they were so happy and elated that they went out into the neighborhood and recruited everybody and had a big party showing them off. And, you know, they felt... they felt very worthy, very adequate. High self-esteem. And the parents never had a little heart-to-heart talk, birds and bees, about who they really were. Parents got so excited about their new kids, they decided, hey, let's have more babies and more eaglets. And so they went out looking for a new property on a new tree, a new place, location to build a new nest. And they didn't take the time to inform the little new arrival eaglets that they were going to be gone, and when they'd be back, they just kind of left and got excited. Like I say, they never told them who they were as far as being eagles. And first day wasn't too bad. They started getting a little hungry, and next thing you know, they kind of began to wonder, where's Mom and Dad? We're getting hungry. Where are they? And fear started creeping up, and they began to question what's really going on. Second day, they really started getting up in their head. They started buying into some lies. Well, I guess they just don't care about us, and we're no good, we're worthless, and something must be wrong with us, and why would they just leave us? And they've left us, and fear creeps in even more, and they buy further into a lie. By the third day, they're really up in their head by now, and now that judgment, so to speak, turned into resentment, and now they've gone from being hurt to being angry. Now, you know, that's how unforgiveness works. Now they're beginning to judge their parents and say they were no good and worthless themselves, and they're angry. And so after about 3 days, they start trying to take matters into their own hands, and out of survival instinct, they start looking down over, and they say, boy, that's a long ways down there, and we could get hurt. And, you know, finally, after all that, the pain of being afraid and by themselves is so great, they figured, you know, if we die, we die, but it can't be more painful than living the way we are. So they decided to step out of their fear and jump out of the nest, and lo and behold, they survived. So they started walking through the woods, and it wasn't long before they heard some cackling noises. They went over to see what it was about, and they ran into a gang of turkeys. And not knowing who they were, they thought these must be our friends or folks or people that are like us. And so the turkeys were glad to take them right on in and bring them into their fold, and they began to feed them acorns, and they were grateful at the time, and they felt loved again. How many know people that are starved for love will look for love anywhere? Yeah. Whether it's a gang or a garbage can, if you need love, you know, you'll join up with anybody. And that's why gangs are so good, or big. So anyway, they got brought in by these turkeys, and everything was good. But over a period of time, him and his sister began to realize that they didn't look like the rest of these other guys, you know. They didn't walk like them. They couldn't talk like them. And when they tried to play little reindeer games or turkey games, they were very unsuccessful. They became very, very frustrated and began to think in their head again, maybe something's wrong with us. Why can't we be good turkeys like everybody else and be successful? And so they just kept trying harder and harder and harder and becoming more and more unsuccessful. And finally, one day, the male eagle goes to the big grandfather of the whole tribe and starts talking about his frustrations, and the big master turkey says that there's something he needs to tell him that he's never told him before. His son, you need to understand, you're not really a turkey at all. You're not really one of us. We brought you in and loved you, but you're not really a turkey. He says, you're really a buzzard. So now, not only does he not know he's an eagle, now he thinks he's a turkey and can't be it. Now he's gone from low to the lowest. Now I'm not even a good turkey. Now I'm a buzzard, and buzzards are the most worthless, but don't tell anybody. So just tell everybody you're a turkey. So he lives that way for a while. He accepts that, swallows it, but you know, he just has been to the lowest as far as self-worth and self-esteem, being a buzzard. That's about getting no lower than that. Finally, one day he's going through the woods and he runs into an owl, a wise old owl. And the wise old owl says, poor little thing, what's wrong with you? And he says, starts talking to the owl and says, you know, I'm just a turkey. I'm no good. I'm worthless. And I'll never measure up or amount to anything. And I try and try, and I just don't know what to do. And I just feel so out of whack. And these acorns, the worst food in the world. And I can't stand all them turkeys, and they don't like me either, and I don't know what to do. And wise old owl says, well, who told you you were a turkey? He said, what do you mean? Who told me I'm a turkey? Of course I'm a turkey. And pride comes up, and he begins to defend, rationalize, and minimize. And how many of you ever do that when you get attacked?
I'm not upset. I'm not angry. What are you talking about? That was not me. Here's the problem.
So wise old owl wisely backs off and says he's just not ready yet. But he'll learn the hard way. So he goes back, and the little turkey just rededicates his life to being a turkey again. So he goes back and said, I'm just going to try harder. So he goes back and he tries harder and harder and harder, but it just gets worse and worse and worse. And finally he's to the point of being suicidal. And he goes searching for this owl. He says, I got to talk to this owl. So finally he runs into the owl again and says, you know, if I'm not a turkey and you're not a turkey, you're a bird, there must be other kinds of birds, but what am I? And the owl says, the reason you're having problems is you just don't know who you really are.
Yeah.
And he says, well, who am I? And he says, well, you're not a turkey at all, you're an eagle. You aren't meant to be hanging around with the turkeys. You're meant to be the eagle. You're meant to be soaring in the wind. And about that time, a wind came through and caught him by accident, and it threw him up into the air. And all of a sudden, by natural, he spread out his wings that he never even knew he had. And next thing I know, the wind took him and carried him up above the mountains. And man, he just starts flapping his wings effortlessly. And all of a sudden, there's like this paradigm shift. All of a sudden, these lights start coming on. He's flapping in wings, and all of a sudden, the divine inspiration, the way he was created to be, finally came alive, and the truth finally came out, and he looked down, and he saw all them turkeys running around the ground, and he realized he had bought into a lie. He had been turkeyized.
Yeah.
So it's hard to soar with eagles when you've been hanging out with turkeys. So have you been turkeyized tonight? So let's take a look at our little test. I'll just tell you right off, Hans, questions 1 through 9 are all false. So if you answer true to any of those, you've been turkeyized in that area. A good description of a Christian is a sinner saved by grace. That's the definition, but it's not a good definition. We are sinners, we are saved by grace, but we're not sinners. We're now saints, holy ones who sometimes sin. Number 2, you can sin and not know it. That's false. Like I said, we've got the Holy Spirit living it, and His job is to convict us of sin. So if you sin and you don't know it, then you don't have the Holy Spirit living in you, or you've quenched and dulled the Spirit to the point where you don't even know you're sinning anymore. Is it normal for a Christian to sin every day? If you see it as normal to sin every day, then you're going to expect to sin. You're going to be highly sin conscious. How many can go 60 seconds without sinning? Nobody can do that?
Yeah.
I think you can pull that one off, don't you?
Yeah.
How many think you can maybe stretch it and maybe go for 120 seconds, two minutes? If you can do it for 2 minutes, then why not try it for 60? Why not do 1 hour? I could lock myself in a door and hit myself with a hammer and get an hour. Maybe. But you know, what's to say we couldn't put together 24 hours and maybe 2 days or 3 days? I actually was thinking about this then, and I started thinking today, how many, what sins I committed, and I realized I don't think I committed one today. That's normal for me. I mean, I don't sin every day. Believe it or not, it's just not normal. I do sin, I do make mistakes, but it's not my normal way. A bad thought is a sin. That's a lie. A sin is an act and not a thought. I can walk into a bank and say, boy, I sure would like to rob this bank and have that thought, but I don't rob the bank. Now, I may see pretty girls and say, recognize they're pretty, but that doesn't make me act upon that in my mind and follow through with something. Thoughts are, come from the devil all day long, but those are thoughts. Those are just flaming air. That's the way the devil works, but that's not who I am. It is easier for a Christian to sin than to do right. If you're an eagle, it should never be hard to act like an eagle. But it's hard for an eagle. It's easy for an eagle to be an eagle, but it's hard for an eagle to act like a turkey. My way of life, should be easy to be a Christian. The closer we get to Christ, the less we're tempted. That's a lie. In actuality, the more closer we get to Christ, the closer we get to the battle line, the more tempted we get. The more of a threat we are to the devil. Number 7, we get closer to Christ through actions of righteousness. Like I said, I'm already righteous. I can't get no more righteous than I already am. Sainthood is attained by only a few Christians. There's no levels of sainthood. You're either a saint or you're not a saint. There's levels of maturity, but there's not levels of sainthood. Either a saint is a holy one. It's someone who's been declared right standing with God. To be tempted is a sign of sinfulness. As long as you're in this body, you're going to be tempted because that's the nature of the flesh. Jesus himself was tempted. Now let's talk about the good stuff here, 10 through 13. Okay. Yeah, go ahead and put that up. How many sins have you committed today? I don't need you to raise your hand, but how many acts of righteousness have you committed today? Well, the average person answered that 3 sins to 1 act of righteousness. They went to a seminary and questioned them, and they actually had 2 to 1, that they actually sinned 2 times, twice as much as they did acts of righteousness. If you have that kind of understanding, that says that if you see yourself as sinning way more than you do acts of righteousness, man, it shows that you've got a very unhealthy concept. And a very wrong understanding of that. And how in the world can you be successful when you're saying I'm only I've got 3 sins to every 1 act of righteousness? How in the world can you be successful with that? How righteous is Jesus Christ on a scale of 1 to 100? I hope all you got that one right. But how righteous are you on a scale of 100? Most people acted, maybe 40, maybe 50 or 60, which is a lie. If you've been born again and justified, declared right standing, you're 100% just exactly right, as righteous as Jesus Christ. Therefore, everything you do is righteous. Everything you do. So if you have that kind of concept, you know, that wrong concept of righteousness, and you've been lied to, then you're going to be finding yourself striving. If you see yourself only 40 or 50% or 60% righteous, then you're always going to be striving to say, I've got to earn my righteousness. That's a total lie. Our righteousness was given to us as a gift. It was imputed to us. We didn't earn it. We didn't work for it. It was given to us as a byproduct of salvation, as a gift. By grace you have been saved. If you don't see that and you don't understand, you're always going to be striving to become more righteous. And you just like what the devil said, that's like trying to break into a house that you already own.
Yeah.
Crazy. It's going to make us more highly sin conscious. If I see myself as dirty and I wearing rags that are filthy and got oil all over, then I'm not going to care much about getting a little bit more oil, a little more dirt on them. But if I see myself in a white tuxedo and I'm getting ready to go out to a ball, then I'm going to be really, really careful not to get that thing stained at all. But if you see yourself as dirty and not, then you're not going to care about what's one more sin. It's going to make you highly sin conscious. But if you're righteous conscious, then you want to stay righteous. Wow. I want to maintain this. I don't want to let anything taint this garment. It's going to make you feel unworthy. I'll never measure up. I'm not good enough. It's going to make you feel inadequate. I just don't have what it takes. And then it's going to end up like the little baby feeling condemned where, oh well, what's the use? This is as good as it gets. Hopeless despair. I might as well give it up and just shoot myself. So a wrong concept will give a wrong response. Proverbs 23:7, we talk about our belief determines our behavior. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. We said before, as in our belief systems in the heart, if I think that I'm a loser, I'm going to act like a loser. If I think I'm worthless, I'm going to act worthless. If I'm going to see myself as ugly, I'll act ugly. If I see myself as no good, inadequate. However, if I see myself as a winner, I'm going to act like a winner. If I see myself like a saint, I'm going to act like a saint. If I see myself righteous like God, then I'm going to work hard at just being who I am. So we want to change our behavior. We have to go down into our belief system, to the root of the problem. So if we have a wrong concept, then we need to get a right concept. We'll have a wrong response. So to get a correct response, we've got to go back and correct the concept. Is that true?
Yes.
And this is where it comes important that we understand who we are in Christ. So there's something we need to know that we know that we need to know about righteousness. The exact moment that I accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior, I was born again as a byproduct that God's righteousness was imputed to me. His righteousness, I didn't earn it, I didn't work for it. I was pronounced righteousness, declared in right standing with God, just as if I'd ever sinned. He cleaned the slate, and now when he looks at me, he sees his righteousness, and now I'm 100% righteous.
Yes.
I'm as righteous as Jesus Christ. If you think that's arrogant, then I'm sorry. That's just what God says about me. What God says about me is all that really matters. So God says that, but do I believe that? So now that I've been pronounced and in this new position of righteousness, everything I do is a righteous act. Except when I sin. When I woke up today and got out of bed, to me that was a big righteous act. Well, again, that's the first big one, but that was a righteous act. Then I got cleaned up and shaved and all, that was a righteous act. Gave my dog a few hugs, that was a righteous act. I had my quiet time, that was a righteous act. Went to the gym, that was another big righteous act. But nobody sees those as righteous acts. Took a little nap today, rest up before here. That was a righteous act. Imagine that.
Yeah.
Went out to have a little lunch. Righteous. Everything I do is righteous. Except when I sin. And if I do sin, I've got an advocate with the Father. If I confess my sins, He's faithful to forgive me for my sins and cleanse me from all righteousness. So positionally, I didn't get any better than that. eagles don't have to work hard at being eagles. You know, they just spread their wings and they don't even have to flap. They just spread their wings and it's easy to be an eagle. They just be eagles. And so let me ask you tonight, have you been turkeyized? No. If you find yourself striving to earn your righteousness, you've been turkeyized. You know, if you're feeling sin conscious and unworthy and inadequate and feeling condemned, then it's obvious that you've been lied to and you've been turkeyized. You bought into a lie and you're in a self-imposed prison. We don't have to strive to, we already are righteous, therefore because we're righteous and we know we're right now, thrive.
Amen. Amen.
Live life, hold your head high, enjoy it. Everything you do is righteous. God looks upon you and smiles all day long. Everything you do is a good thing for Him, except when you sin. And if you do sin, he's got a backup. And so we know that we've been pronounced righteous. We've been declared in right standing with God. We're going to heaven and we're going to live forever and forever and forever. That's who you really are.
Amen.
And Romans 5:17 says, those who have received the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness will reign in life. How many of you want to reign?
Yeah.
Word reign means to have complete dominion. It means to rule, to have authority. I don't know about you, but I like living life today, walking in confidence, with a sense of confidence about who I am, and I'm not ashamed. When I go to Walmart and I walk around old buddies and old familiar places, I hold my head, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, man. I'm not ashamed of who I am. I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. I die tonight and I'm going to heaven. This is going to get better and better and better. Y'all are the ones that are missing out. Bill Gates, Oprah, and all these people and all that, millionaires, LeBron James, all these people, man, they ain't got nothing on me. I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. I have arrived. I am successful. I am significant. I am like God. I am as righteous as Jesus Christ is. I receive my righteousness. I get it. Do I forget it sometimes? Yes, but I receive my righteousness. And therefore, I have a tendency to be above and not below. I rule and reign in my life today as the most part, and I enjoy it because I know who I am in Christ.
Yes.
So understanding your identity in Christ is absolutely essential if you're ever going to rule and reign in life. So how many of you tonight have received your righteousness?
Yes.
Great saints are great receivers. You just have to receive it. You can't. It's something that God did for you. It's a gift.
Mm-hmm.
And it's available to all. So maybe tonight, have received it and you know this, or maybe you haven't and maybe your eyes are being opened. So bow your heads and I just want to pray tonight. Lord, I pray tonight that you'll give us revelation, enlightenment, understanding through the Holy Spirit that lives inside of us. Take us to a deeper place of conviction and understanding who we are in Christ. And we choose by faith now to receive our righteousness and trust that we begin to reign even more and more now that we've found out who we are in Christ. In Jesus' name, amen.
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 Don't
be an eagle.